A world-renowned authority on Indian painting, our guest for the afternoon is Dr. B N Goswamy, who will be in conversation with the Chandigarh Lalit Kala Akademi. Welcome, sir, to the.
Thank you, Parul.
And how are you? And your new book is out, and the spirit of Indian painting. Mm-hmm. So, and it has 101 paintings which you have analyzed and which you have written about, and of course, it's a heavily illustrated book. So tell us a little about the book and how you bring Indian painting close to readers who may not be art connoisseurs like you, but may love art.
Parul, there's nothing new that I've said in that book. I've been saying this over and over again. But some things sometimes come together in a nice way. I was asked by Penguin through Nandini Mehta, a friend whom I have known for some time, to put together a book for them accessible to the general public. Okay. Not to the completely uninformed, but people who might be initially interested in this but have a difficulty entering works of art. And this entry into works of art is critical, as far as I am concerned, as an end of art. Right. So we discussed it, and I said, I'm interested, I'm tempted to do this, except that I don't fully understand, or know how you would like me to approach. She said, it's completely up to you. She said, however, Nandini said to me, ek shart hai. Shart to nahi hai, is a desire, a wish of ours, that you should write as you speak. So, a very nice thing on her part to say. She must have heard me speak. I do that constantly, more than I should. And I took it up as a challenge, both a compliment and a challenge, but more of a challenge when it comes down to writing it. Because what she meant was that it should be accessible. It should not have the kind of high-flown jargon which our art history generally is loaded with and things like this. Or minor squabbles between art historians. This is the date and this is not the date, or this was done in this place or at this place, or this was the painter and not so and so and so. Now, these have all their place in life. And these are in a certain sense the art historian's bread and butter. But I have done my bit of research, hard core research, and spent a lot of time doing these things. But when I speak and I address audiences wherever I'm asked to, then what is uppermost in my mind is that I should really be able to, if I can, if it is within my reach, to take the painter, take the viewer, into a work of art. What is it that the painter must have had in his mind? There are people who do things for their own pleasure. Swanta Sukhai, as we say it in Sanskrit, for their own pleasure. But I am pretty certain in my own mind, some of it could be done like that, but everyone wants to communicate.
Right.
Whether it's a painter or a poet or whoever it is. And if that person is trying to communicate something to us, then in a sense we have to enter his skin or his layers of his thought. What exactly is it that he is trying to say? Or if he said it, then am I getting it? Mm. So there are, all arts are coded, right? A work of art is essentially coded. And the key is not only in the hand of the person who's made that work of art, but should also be gently handed over to the viewer. Here is the key. Okay. Open it, right? Speak to the work of art and it will speak back to you. Something like that. So this is what I did. or at least set out to do. I may have done it successfully or not, I don't know. But, you know, there are issues relating to art which affect our basic understanding of what it is all about. I have opened that book with a short epigraph from Kavyartha, which is not a text, it is just a concept which many people keep discussing about. But one interpretation, what Kavyartha is, the meaning of poetry, I mean, I'm talking about poetry at this particular moment. He says that when you confront a work of art, then strange things, passingly strange things occur. Starts with the unfolding of the heart. Right? The heart is tight and it has to be unfolded. And leading to expansion of the heart, leading to agitation in the heart, and finally vibration. A work of art has to leave something in the nature of vibration in you, according to this particular way of looking at things. And I like that. Vibration you can translate as spandan, as kampan, as sansanahat, or whatever. But if it produces something of a response inside of you, and that vibration, a very, very gentle vibration, which can last for a very long time, then we have achieved something, right? Then if we have, if I have or you have, succeeded in bringing it within the ken of the viewer, that this is what it is, right? No two people see the same object with the same pairs of eyes.
That's right.
So it always depends upon what the level of not only comprehension, but the level of interest a person is. You know, Ghalib said something very, very beautiful. He said, Bakshe hai jalwa e gul zauq e tamasha Ghalib. Chashm ko chahiye har rang mein waah ho jana. The work of art yields a delight to the viewer, in his case the listener, according to his capacity to take, his interest in it. Now, whatever the work of art is doing, right, isliye you don't know, chashm ko chahiye, aankh ko chahiye, har rang mein waah ho jana, khula rakhna. We don't know what we are going to get from this particular work, right? Isliye zauqe tamasha, the desire to know, is critical, is absolutely critical. I think it's a very fine utterance. I mean, but what else can you expect of Ghalib? Fine utterance is what it is all about. So, this is the way I went about it. We, basically what, who was it, Sahir Dhyanvi, when he wrote his famous Talkhiyan, when the first, the opening couplet, I mean, kind of an epigraph, is Duniya ne tajrubat o hawadis ki shakl mein jo kuch mujhe diya hai wo lauta raha hoon, right? Now in my case there are not many hawadis and not many accidents, but tajrubat, experiences I have had, right, with works of art, and whatever I have received from them I am offering it back. And so on.
So you took 2 years to write the book, and apparently the toughest part was zeroing in on 100 and 101 works, mm-hmm. because you have studied Indian art and Indian painting for so many decades and so minutely with great deal of research, etc. So how did you zero in on those 100 works, and how was the process? And you also talked about issues on art, mm-hmm. that mm-hmm. many of us can't see art or don't appreciate it in a certain way. So what in your years that you have seen are the issues that confront ancient or traditional Indian painting, which we as...
Yeah, you asked me three questions, yes. rolled up, like a cigar. Right? selection.
Yes.
We started off in the preliminary discussion I had with Nandini and the friend at Penguin, including Chikki Sarkar and Ambar Chatterjee. how many paintings should be there in that book. Initially, the thought was 75.
Okay.
And I, you know, was uncomfortable with that. How does one represent a range of Indian painting? One can't represent it with 1,000 pictures, but I mean, 75 appeared to me to be too few. So I persuaded them, let's go up to 100. So that was agreed upon.
Okay.
So initially it began as 100 great objects or works of art. And then at the last minute I discovered a painting which I had never seen before, which I just could not resist. So now it's become 101 great works of art. And many people think it is a kind of a magical number, the,
yes,
you know, the traditional one above 100, ekottar shataram, something like that. It isn't that. It just happened to be that irresistible as a work of art, and I said, I have to bring it in. So 101. You know, this was a very tough process for me, tough period. In fact, I finally committed myself to writing this book. I said, after I have really narrowed down my choice, it took me the better part of 6 months to do that. It happened eventually. Luckily for me, I didn't have to go from museum to museum or private collector to private collector, because I had a large number of paintings in my head. And it is in my head that I was searching, ye ya ye, why this and why not this? And nobody has to agree with my choice, and I've said this in the book. I mean, it's very personal, very, very personal. Cannot be anything else,
right?
So it's not that you have, there is a long period over which many people said this, 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 and you cannot have a book on European painting without the Mona Lisa being there or a Rembrandt self-portrait being there and so on. We're not talking about that. There's very little of this kind which has been established, that these are the great masterworks of India, right? So it took me a long time, and I, in fact, I had it in my mind to say the subtitle of my main title of the book should be Nobody Has to Agree, right? Nobody has to agree. I mean, I'm sure my colleagues, I mean, who are art historians, would be sitting and like, "Is kya kiya isne? Iski bajaye ye hona chahiye tha," right? Something like that. But I claim for myself the privilege. In any case, there is nothing else that you can do. So it's a Hobson's choice. So I really picked up these paintings, and had to be a fine balance to be struck between, let us say, there is a painting series with 101 painting or 154 painting, a series.
Right.
Now from that you have to pick one. Now there is a well-known Bengali proverb saying, "Bash mane dom karna," that in the forest of bamboos, the bamboo cutter goes blind, does not know what to cut and what to leave. So my situation was a little like that. But you chance your arm, you do that. And that's exactly what I've done. But one thing that I did keep in mind was that if a young student picks up this particular book, he should have, he or she should have a range of pictures which cover, first of all, the 100 years that we, 1,000 years more or less, that I picked up as a segment of Indian history. And there should also be a representation of every major style of painting. So I can't leave out Pala, I can't leave out Jain, I cannot leave out Rajput, I cannot leave out, which means neither Pahadi nor Rajasthani, nor Mughal, nor Deccani, nor the South, nor the Northeast, and
okay,
so on. So it's from that point of view, it is, the choice was made a bit tougher. But I persisted, and there it is. For what it's worth.
Yes. And the issues that you talked about,
yeah,
in your
the second layer of your cigar. I don't know how many people, for instance, looking at a work of art, see the subtleties in it. Now there is an view of time that the painter takes. Ordinarily, time is something you associate with the performing arts, with music or dance or theater. Time is not ordinarily seen as an element in the visual arts. Right? But I see it, and it is there. The painter has to take into account, or in a certain sense, weave or knead into his work, his understanding of time. I'll give you a very simple example. In Rajput painting, repeatedly and very frequently, we have on the same folio, on the same leaf, one figure repeated. Right? A painter is seen entering the palace gate from one side, then we see him sort of walk across to the other, the next sort of chamber, and then we see him working three times. Now, logically, if you take the Judeo-Christian view of time, right, the time is like this, it starts at point A and ends at point Z. This doesn't make sense. Right? How can the same person be here, there, and so on? But it is very natural to the Rajput painter, because his view of time is that time is flexible, time is not sort of static, that it is cyclical, it can be manipulated, it can be played with, and so on and so forth. You know, we see this, we hear it in our stories. In the not only religious sort of texts and so on and so forth, but you know, things that you hear, I mean, in terms of anecdotes or stories or whatever it is, and so time is not, you know, fixed, malleable. So that gets reflected in this. I mean, in Mughal painting, you don't see that view of time at all. In Mughal painting, I mean, an ustad would be sitting there approving or disapproving of whatever painters are bringing to him. Is it okay or not okay? And if you see some Rajput painter, because many of the Mughal painters were Hindus. In fact, the majority of them were Hindus. So somebody coming from Gujarat or from Rajasthan or from the Pahadi area might make a rough drawing to take it to the ustad, ki theek hai. Ustad kaya ka, pagal ho. Ye kaise ho sakta? How is it possible this person is here, there, and so on, take it away. So in Mughal painting, you don't see that at all.
Okay.
Yeah? I don't know of more than three examples in the whole range of Mughal painting in which there is this same figure repeated more than once of the same folio. So obviously there is it's a difference, right? The Mughal view or the Islamic view of time is very different from the Hindu, Buddhist, Jain view of time. Likewise, space, right? Now space, I mean, the Renaissance painters, right, they looked at space from a fixed perspective, right? Mm. Who was it? I don't remember a contemporary British painter who said, I mean, the Renaissance people looked at this as if it's a paralyzed cyclops, right? He can't move from this place to there and sees only with one eye. Space is not fixed. Mm-hmm. Space is something, again, manipulable. I mean, you can't describe space. Somebody wrote very nicely that to ask a person to describe space is like asking a fish to describe the nature of water. Right? You are inside it. And our view of space, I mean, the Hindu, Buddhist, Jain view of space is remarkable. And then it is so fluid and so, once again, manipulable. I mean, after all, if I'm looking at this particular glass or this particular one, then if I can only see this, then I will see this. But the moment I move here, or the moment I move the back, or the glass is moved and so on, the whole thing changes. So the view of space, I'm sorry if I'm taking too long over
no,
this.
No.
But these are the kinds of things which interest me, and which I think the average viewer of art,
yes,
if he's provided with, if he or she's provided with a kind of some little understanding of this, some peg, some hook on which to hang his or her understanding of what is going on, it deepens the impact a work of art makes, in my mind. View of portraiture, right? How do you see portraiture, right?
True.
Portraits. Very, very different parts of the country, very different periods of time, very different what style it is and so on. The Mughal view of portraits is of one kind. The Rajasthani or the Pahari view of portrait may be of a very different kind. Mm. I don't want to go into this much of detail, but these are the kind of issues I want in my essay. And this is not, I don't sort of, in the book, I am not, you know, thrusting it down anybody's throat. You may like to read the essay, you may not. So the book is in two different parts. The essay, which is near to my horror, I mean to my, certainly to my surprise, runs into more than 100 pages. This is not what I set out to do. And in the catalogue part, I mean you can straight away jump to the catalogue part and look at each painting that I've selected and written on. The notes are long, but not overly long, and they're not loaded with art historical detail or something. There is some information, and so on. So the essay, to my, in my manner of thinking, is quite critical as far as this is concerned, because then you are able to enter this particular world. It is a world which doesn't reject you. It is not a world which is unfriendly. It just is that we really have to negotiate the first step. And if you are able to negotiate the first step, cross the threshold,
okay,
move into that, then I think it yields a lot, it enhances you, lifts you out of yourself.
Okay. Maybe it's a little intimidating, the process or the journey till there. So how did somebody who's been completely self-taught and how did you chart this journey, and to what effect, in the sense that you've art history is like, you almost have a photographic memory if you can, so many works. You said it all came from your head. So this must be a very fascinating process, if you were to share with us how art lovers can also become, as you said, deepen their understanding of art, especially ancient mm-hmm. Indian painting as mm-hmm. opposed to contemporary. So what drew you to
I prefer the term pre-modern, right?
Okay, pre-modern.
Right. If I were to talk about ancient, then I would have to go back
right.
well before 1100, which is a cutoff point from which I started.
Right?
So, because I wanted to leave the mural sort of tradition out of this completely. Unfair, perhaps, but I wanted to really work, concentrate on works on paper, miniatures, which have their own constraints because of the space, the scale. No. I'm trying to go back in my own mind to the early days. It's been a long time. In my family, we did not have any real interest in the visual arts. I don't remember in my childhood having seen more than two or three images in my own home. Right, some European print, maybe a constable, some photograph of the Shalimar Bagh in Lahore, right, which is a kind of a continuous exposure and so on. One or two calendar prints, and that's about all. It is when I left the civil service, came back to teach, and as a student of history, because that's what I was trained in. I haven't been trained in art history at all. That's what makes me suspect in the eyes of my colleagues. I went abroad to teach, and for the first time really it made an impact upon me. And I saw people talk about art, and museums were everywhere. In a university there may be six professors of art history, something one had not even heard of in India. And there's, so I got interested in that area, really interested. And instead of studying only the social background of painting, which I began with as a student of history, I decided to concentrate upon the foreground, right, upon the paintings themselves. And I got more and more drawn into it, and I had some, what shall I say, some interest in doing field work, not sit in a library, right, and just keep celebrating or theorizing and so on, but see what the situation on the ground is. How do people respond to art? I mean, I was initially interested only in the Pahadi area, because you have to narrow it down. You can't take a sort of a view of all art history or all of India and so on. It's a foolish enterprise. So I was interested in that. And the more I talked to the, you know, people who were in the, I mean, who were descended from painter families, and I was very fortunate in that, the more I started understanding the mindset of the painter. And that I found rich and varied and sensitive, right? I'll give you an example. I'm looking at a painting along with Chandulal, who was descended from the family, Pahadi family of painters, which the great ninths of the 18th century worked. And I was looking at it, and there is Krishna with the gopis and standing in water, full moon night, not Ras Leela, but that is the night on which the Ras Leela began. And he said, can you see there are three moons in this? I can see the full moon in the sky. And then I looked closely and I said, yes, I can see the reflection of the full moon in the water. So two moons I can see. He said, no. Krishna is Krishna Chandra. Right? So the full moon and the reflection of the full moon in the water is directly above his head. Right? And the painter is really, and there are all these sort of young attractive women, the gopis and so on around him. And he's the full moon among stars, like that. Now, I mean, you can dismiss it. At the same time, you can say that it is attractive as a way of seeing. So, little things, and I'm drawn to them. I really am drawn to them. Maybe, I mean, excessively so, maybe foolishly so, I don't know. But sometimes, through a little detail, you know, it throws the switch of imagination in the mind of the viewer. And it opens up. It is as if you have found a key.
Right.
To a code, to a lock or something like that.
And it's a continuing journey.
Yeah, I like the field. I like it a lot. It has enriched me personally. And part of that enrichment, if I could share with anyone, I'm happy to do that. I keep working. Maybe a long time ago somebody wrote a review of a book which was very heavy, right? And the reviewer, who did not really in real life get along too well with the person who written that big tome, he said, ended the review by saying that there is a rumor going around that in the other world, all authors will have to carry their books on their heads. If that is true, this gentleman would be greatly inconvenienced, right? So I'm worried about myself, because there are a number of books that I've written. And if I'm asked to carry them all, I might have major problems, whatever. So I keep working, and I enjoy that, and it keeps me occupied and enriches me all the time, and that's what I do.
And a lot of this work translated into an exhibition recently, Masters of Indian Painting, which was started in Zürich and then traveled to New York.
Yeah, you see, just
tell us a little about that.
You know, one of my major concerns has been, as an art historian, that we have neglected the painter as an individual. You see, because Indian art in general is anonymous, more or less anonymous. And there are millions of works of art produced in the country. And there are only a handful of names of painters which have survived. The most information we have, or used to have, was the Mughal painters, because texts speak of them. But the information is not more than a line about that person. So, I mean, the greatest of the painters, Abul Hasan, for instance, or Mansur, for instance, we know remarkably little about them. I mean, how did they live? I mean, what their families were like? I mean, what the relationship between painter and patron was, things like this and so on. Or what did, were they literate, were they not literate, and things like this, nothing. It's just, I mean, a few names which hang about in the air like fireflies in the night. And just about that. And that worries me. Not worries me, I mean, I found, I mean, after all, the painter is not a simple craftsman who keeps on going, keeps on doing the same thing over and over again. So he's a thinker. Is he, I mean, we have to give him full credit for the fact that he is a really mulling things around, right, in his mind, and he's a thinker. So we can't dismiss him as an imitative craftsman or something like this. And so he has to be seen as a person who's capable of thinking, taking decisions, modifying them, evolving, right, like that. So much of my work, early work, was around this. And I, along with a colleague of mine, I wrote a book which became, as it happens, I mean, a kind of a benchmark in our field, called Pahadi Masters.
Yes.
In which we didn't trace the history of Pahadi painting, but took major painters. Even if we did not know the name of a painter, we said, this is the master of the early Rasamanjari. Rasamanjari is a series, and so we attribute it to that particular person, even if he remains without a name.
Okay.
Right? And so, I mean, there is Pandit Sehu and his son Manuku and his son Nansuk, and then the first generation of the painter Purukhu, and you know, things like this.
Okay.
So Pahadi Masters became an important book as far as I am concerned, and I think the art history field is concerned. And then 5 years ago, I mean, friends of mine, very dear, close colleagues, Eberhard Fischer and Milo Beach and I, we sat down, let's expand the canvas. Instead of only staying with Pahadi painters, let's see who are the masters of Indian painting. So we conceived of this grandiose plan to do that. And it came off. I mean, we didn't write all the things. We were the three principal persons, Milo and Eberhard and I. But we invited people who had worked on individual painters, if they had, we induced them to work on individual painters. And so it's two volumes are printed.
Okay.
And the exhibition opened first in Zürich, and then Museum Rietberg, then it traveled to the Metropolitan Museum in New York. And it was a, I think it was a very important exhibition, because it forced people to think in terms of individuals,
right,
masters.
Mm.
Yeah. So, and it was quite heavily visited, both in Zurich and in New York. And the books, in any case, stand. I mean, you can't do much to destroy them.
Right? That's right. And also, did it lead to, I mean, a lot of your research also says that these painters, when you researched, were not, you did not limit them to the court, but you realized that they were from families, mm-hmm, and it could, the tradition, you know, passed on. So how was that revelation to you? Because earlier it was only like gharanas, like courts, court painters, etc. But in this research, you also found out...
No, forgive me, I have to correct you. Mm-hmm. The gharana thing came from me.
Came from you.
Yeah, but the court is not, there's no connection of court with the gharana.
That's right.
The classification of paintings,
right,
used to be, I mean, along
Mughal,
the lines of, this is Kangra painting, yes, this is Guler painting, this is Basoli painting.
Yes.
And I found that unacceptable.
Okay.
Unacceptable for this reason, that in the Indian situation, it is not the European situation of the 16th, 17th centuries. The styles were not confined to, but mainly stayed with families.
Right.
Then music, for instance.
Like Gharana,
I mean, you
okay.
have the Agra Gharana.
Yes.
Does not mean everyone born in Agra sings in that particular style.
Mm.
Right? Or people, somebody from, let us say, from Lucknow or from Gwalior can't come and to Rostad and learn in the Agra style. So there's a kind of affiliation to a particular style which runs in a family. Family does not have to mean blood relations, can be pupils, disciples who in a certain way adapt themselves to or grow up in that particular style. So I had major differences with scholars at that particular time in the field, including William Archer, who was a great friend of mine. And then I produced in 1968, I think. Yeah, 1968 for sure. A long essay which was published as, it was the only essay in that special edition of Marg magazine. And it was titled Pahari Painting, because that's what I had worked on. The family is the basis of style.
Okay.
Right? In which I argued it out. Why the family is the basis of style and how one particular family style developed in this particular fashion. Now it created, I think, a sizable impact upon certainly the younger who are not committed, younger scholars, that this is a way of looking. I mean, I can't defend everything I've said in that particular essay, but I don't think I any longer need to defend it, because it has really, in a certain sense, entered the thinking of a great many people who are working in these areas and so on. So the court style, you know, let's assume that there is a am I going on for too long? The court assumes that the court dictates this particular style.
Haan ji.
Right? Or there is a Kangra, let us say. And when you say it's a Kangra style, you are assuming that in Kangra there is only one style. In fact, in Kangra or in Basoli or in Guler, there could be four different families of artists.
Okay.
Who are all working in their own individual styles. Now they don't have to be equally good, don't have to be equally bad, right? So I said this is, it's not, then what do you do? Do we call it Kangra A, Kangra B, Kangra C, Kangra D?
Mm.
Or do you say this particular family working in Kangra, this family workshop? So this was the paradigm shift that I was, in a certain sense, I had arrived at in my own mind, and I was trying to advocate.
Mm.
So the Pahari masters, the masters of Indian painting and so on, so are in a certain sense all outflows of that erratic thought which I had in my own
no,
mind.
No, but this was really heartbreaking. And this is how Nensuk, which you have talked about a lot, written about, was this how this
yeah,
was
yeah,
discovered?
I mean, you know, Nensuk, the will of the wisp, I mean, his name was known, but who exactly was he, or where did he live, what his relationships were, what kind of work did he do? I got very interested in, and finally I did produce a book on him. And some of my work in this direction was done with the pandas in
yes,
the
we read about that. Was fascinating that you went, yes.
Nobody had ever tapped that particular source. And I was lucky to have had this sort of flash of thought that maybe there we can find information on the painters. And so I, for 3 years, Parul, I did not anything else except go from place of pilgrimage to place of pilgrimage.
Okay.
Starting with Kurukshetra, Pehova, Haridwar, Marthand, Gaya, and so on, so forth, Jwalamukhi.
Mm.
So in the Pandas family, in the registers, initially I found very little information, but slowly started adding up a great deal. I had a virtual census of painters in this area. That is what enabled me to go into the whole reconstruction of a family and its style, something like that. Nansuk figured very prominently.
Yes,
in that.
That's okay.
And when I wrote that book on him, what, 20 years ago? I had been working on him for 20 years before that, trying to pursue him, right, where, and gathering up little bits of information. And I finally wove them all together. And this. Incidentally, to my great regret, that is the only book on any individual painter of the past. I mean, if you go to Europe, I mean, you take any major painter, I mean, Rembrandt or Titian or something, and you will have slews of books thrown at you, right? Because the situation is very different. And here we don't have any book, right? And essays, yes.
Okay.
Little short essays and something like that and so on. But no book on any painter till the point I had wrote that.
Yeah, it was the first, probably, yeah, which is on.
The Milo has a book on Bhaktan Chokha.
Okay.
Ashok has a book on Mansoor and so on like this. So something is happening in this. But when I worked on the Nansuk book, this was the only book ever written on an individual painter of the past.
But why haven't we documented? What has kept us from documenting or studying art history? Or it's very, as you mentioned, as compared to Europe, because
yeah, there are various ways of looking at it or trying to find an answer. It's not easy. Anonymity in art is a given as far as India is concerned. Because that is the rule. Everything else is an exception.
Okay.
Right? And why anonymous? Some people have said the painters are illiterate. It's not true. Even if they were illiterate, the society was not illiterate.
Right.
Somebody could have written about them. But one particular thing that, I mean, Kumaraswamy at one point said, Indian art is anonymous. Because, he said emphatically, anonymity is in accordance with the truths, the capital T. Right? That you are only, the painter believed that he was only an instrument, a medium, through which some higher things, sort of higher powers sort of flew, so to speak.
Okay.
So he did not take credit to himself. In, some people said that in Mughal painting, very often three painters collaborated on the same leaf. One of them drew the outline, the other one put in the colors and so on. The third one added portraits and things like this, which is true. So who should one give credit to? Things like this. But I don't think these are all valid. I think there is something in it that you have created something. And you want to lurk in the shadows of that bright light that you have brought into me. Not enough. You know, it's very interesting. In sacred texts, the author will open, say, I'm not the first one doing this. Before me, so-and-so have written on this.
That's right.
Giving credit to previous generations. Right? I mean, it's quite the opposite of what we do. I mean, we might have learned everything from people, but today, I mean, we just say, this is my thought, this is what I've done, and so on. So the mindsets are different. I'm talking about, on the one hand, of literature, on the other hand, I'm talking of painting.
Painting, okay. Which leads us to contemporary Indian art. How do you view it as passionately as...
It's a different story, and I don't think we have time for it today. Maybe another day. Maybe another day. I'm very fond of it.
Okay.
Not all of it.
Okay.
I'm not, let's say, overly fond of everything which is being done.
Okay.
And commerce has taken over, right, in a very, very big way. Which on the one hand is good, on the other hand is not so good, right? So, but it's a long story, and I have some views on it, but maybe when you have the time, I'll talk to you about it.
So you were talking about that you are fond of some of the contemporary art, but a lot of commerce has taken over. So if you could talk a little about it.
One can make sweeping statements in this particular regard. One can be partial, one is living in the midst of it, so to speak. But the practitioners of art today, I mean, they also know, I'm sure many of them are aware of the fact that it's a golden time to be an artist, right? In India, it wasn't ever so. I mean, the galleries, right? And they have sprung up, I mean, like Barsati Medics and so on, right? Have a great deal to do with this. The auction houses have a great deal to do with this.
Okay. Right?
So the greasy hand of commerce is everywhere. You build up an artist, right? And, you know, competition, this and that and so on, and then fakes are entering the market. And so you cannot deny the fact that commerce is very much a part of the art world today. Maybe it always has been, I don't think so. But maybe I'm reading the whole thing wrong. So that's why one has to be very alert to be able to detach oneself from all the painted word, right, which we are surrounded by. I mean, like you have paid news in the newspapers,
yes,
right? So you have this kind of a paid buttressing of artists, because it benefits everyone, the artist, the gallery owner, and the person who's buying it, more or less for investment rather than anything else.
Right.
I hope I'm not being unfair, but I think on the one hand the galleries have played a major role, on the other hand they also have in a sense a devalued art. Right? Mm-hmm. So major talents would lie undiscovered because they do not have the wherewithal to establish the right connections. Networking is so much a part of all this and so on. But, you know, there's a remarkable talent in the country. There's no question about it. Remarkable talent. So you have to have a discerning eye. You have to have the ability to detach yourself from verbiage. Right, to zero in on 8 or 10 painters whose work, I mean, I feel very moved by contemporary painters. And this is not the place to argue about or for them or against them and so on. So what I'm saying is that contemporary art is valuable. Some very good work is being done, some very bad work is at the same time being done. It's not necessary that the very good work fetches more price than the very bad work does and things like this and so on. So it's a very, difficult world to enter in terms of discernment.
Okay.
Sensationalism is one thing. I mean, there are many painters whose work, for instance, will go down the tube tomorrow. Completely. I mean, when the fashion, the mode of that is over, that is gone. Like, at the same time, the thinking artists, and there are a great many of them, I mean, will probably go from strength to strength. Right? So, one of the things that I've noticed, however, is that the foundation of many of the painters, right, is thin. Right? Now, if you do not know your past, right, if you have not taken advantage of the knowledge of the past and so on, then I think you made an error somewhere. You know, who was it, William Faulkner, who said, the past is not dead, it's not even past, right? Mm. It's living with us. So you can only, I'm not recommending, or whom am I to recommend? that you should be conscious of what you have inherited, what is there. Now, a great many of the young, and maybe even the older ones, I mean, taken an aesthetic, right, which they have not grown with or grown into, but which has in a certain sense been brought in from outside. I have nothing against outside, but if you have a strength of your own, right, I mean, let's say like Mani Subramanian has, right, or Gulam has, or Bhupen used to have, and so on and so forth, or Krishan has, right, then you produce a different kind of work, which probably will outlast the work of many others.
True.
Right? So I think that is a kind of a situation which I wish had not been there. I'm not saying anybody of all people should be painting in the old style, by no means. Absolutely would be foolish both to expect it and to recommend it. But richness which comes from understanding where we come from, right? Something to be wished for.
Okay. And to the question where we come from, you've been in Chandigarh for many, many decades, and what has the city given you in terms of creativity, or in terms of solace, or in terms of philosophy, whatever? Or has influenced you, or you in the process have influenced the city?
I'll answer it in two parts if I may.
Okay.
I have spent a fair amount of my time living, not living abroad, but traveling abroad. I've taught at many universities. 9 years I was in Heidelberg, not continuously, but one semester there, one in India. 3 years I was in Pennsylvania, and so on and so forth. So I've had no dearth of opportunities to settle abroad, to keep working abroad and settle abroad. And I've always said no. I want to be here because I want to stay close to my materials, to my sources, to my environment, which gives me strength, which gives me the kind of grounding that I need in my life. So then the question is, if I want to be in India, in my own sort of a cultural space, then why Chandigarh? I still find Chandigarh the most livable city in the whole of India. Most livable. It happened to be, I was teaching at the university, and this was the headquarters of the university. So one can argue, one can say that this is not a matter of choice. I mean, it was something that you are in a university job, and so university happens, so you have to be here. But even here, I mean, I had opportunities to settle elsewhere, teach at other universities, which I kept declining. But this I find the most attractive city in the whole of the country. I enjoy visiting this city, that city, and so on. Every city has some merit and some demerit. But on balance, Chandigarh is the city where you have a sense of, you know, space and clean edge to things, which you don't get in too many places. And I've been fortunate in the fact that the university has been, you know, in a certain sense very open about. I mean, any other university could have said to me, what is this art history and so on, why are you doing this? And even when I founded the Department of Art History here, and I will not take credit away from Dr. Mulk Raj Anandam, I mean, who was appointed to go professor well before I moved into this here. But the department was founded by me here. It could easily have been that the university could have said, I mean, there's a history department and that's about all. But we had enlightened vice chancellors, gave me the opportunity to found a department. The department did quite well for some years and made an impact. So it's like that. a combination of things, and then it's a manageable environment. Right? It is not a mega city. There's not the pressures of that. I can get from one end of the city to another. It's a group of persons that I personally interact with and feel enriched by, and so on. So the kind of you could call me a small town boy or something like that, but I don't think it is exactly that. Yes. Chandigarh has opportunities, has given me space to breathe and live the kind of life that enables me to do the work that I do. And of late, I mean the last 10 years or so, the cultural content of the city has become much richer than it used to be. And for that, I mean, the Lalit Kala Akademi here, the Sahitya Natak Academy here, and then the Sangeet Natak and the Sahitya Academies and so on, they've all contributed. And galleries which sort of appear now and disappear tomorrow and so on, they've all, in any case, some desire has been on the part of people who founded them or located them here, that it is something which is worth doing. So the university being here and these academies being here and a group of people who are genuinely interested, I mean the music for instance, so one I see Chandigarh in relationship to Delhi, which is the closest big city it is to, as in Philadelphia is to New York. And you can get almost everything that you do, you can get there, maybe after time gap or something like that and so on, but and it's rich, it is rich. And I'm grateful that I'm a part of it.
And Chandigarh, to have you. Thank you.
Well, that
no, you said it was very tough for you to zero in on, from such a vast repertoire. So, is there another book in the offing after this one?
Because there is a book in the offing, but not along these lines.
Okay, not the second part of The Spirit of Indian Painting.
The book in the offing is on the painter Manuku, whom I'm extremely fond of, who's the elder brother of Nainsukh, and he's on the one hand, a very traditional painter compared to Nainsukh, who was innovative and who was kind of a light touch to him. Manuku is grave.
Okay.
And, but he's soaked in the tradition and has a wonderful imagination. In one of the paintings, which I'm extremely fond of, which is on this particular flyer of, the golden egg.
Yes.
Amazing painting, that's in Manuku. So I've had 2 years of Tagore National Fellowship from the government, Ministry of Culture, and that was a theme that I decided to work on, the painter Manuku and the environment in which or his circle. And he's a remarkable painter, remarkable, different flavor than that of Nainsukh, but remarkable. So that is something I've been working on.
Okay.
And I'm hoping to finish it in another 6 months. I've collected all the material on him.
Okay.
And maybe that will come to fruition. Who knows? But another 101 works or 20 works and so on is unlikely, is very unlikely.
Okay. And you mentioned the research which you did a lot, you went to different pilgrimage points and collected a lot of information about painters. So in your mind, is such a tradition exists in other parts of the country only?
In Rajasthan,
or is it
certainly did.
It did. And
in Rajasthan, it certainly did.
Okay.
And basically, in terms of research, we have only reached or explore the tip of the iceberg.
Right.
There's an enormous amount of material lying around which one has to
tap.
When I worked on the pandas and their records, I remember it was at Simla the Institute of Advanced Study, and Dr. Nihar Ranjan Rai was the first, the founder director. We had a very early on a big seminar, and I made a presentation of the records of Greece as a source of information or history. I don't remember the exact title. And we had historians there, I mean, who were completely startled by the range of material that the Pandas had. And they had never looked in that direction. I was looking at it only from this point of view, reconstructing the genealogies of painter families. And I said, this is an enormous area to explore. Because 400 years back, the record started, because paper came in late in India. And so this was being done. And you can put that material to endless use. Endless use. You can study demographics, mm-hmm. right? You can study languages, dialects, scripts, relationships of families, and so on and so forth, like that, and so on. So I set forth in that short article, essay that I presented on that occasion, and so on. And I mean, it has made some kind of a contribution to the field. Rajasthan is very, very rich, and I'm constantly amazed at how rich their record keeping was.
Okay.
So that is that. Bhogal things have been lost more or less, but even if you start assembling them and so on, you might succeed. I don't know the south, I really do not, nor the northeast. But the northeast, I mean, the kind of stuff that one sees, which has hardly ever been published.
Right.
I have published it, a small amount of it, but only at second remove. I didn't do any original research in that area. A couple of books which came to my notice, the people that I met and so on, drew my attention to this. And I obsessively have gone back to that particular objects from Assam, for instance. It's a remarkable work. One of them is in this book of mine. And I just recently wrote an article for the Tribune, I mean, in my column, I'm drawing attention to the Northeast. And so it's seriously worth looking at. When I was asked to curate an exhibition in the Indian manuscript tradition in Frankfurt, this is about 8 years ago, then I had occasion to explore various, you know, a small group of people working with me. But I was constantly being, you know, made aware of how much there is in other areas of India. Yeah?
Right.
I'll give you an example, a very interesting, and that's where we will conclude. Gita Govinda, which is one of the great texts of India, 11th century, 12th century, Jayadev, and every performer, every dancer, every musician knows the Gita Govinda and so on. And I was looking for manuscripts of the Gita Govinda. We have some from the Rajasthan, some from the Pahari area. And one person brought a necklace of beads and said, there it is. I said, I'm looking for manuscripts. And he said, just see this. And the beads, like the, you know, that sacred bead for Shiva, the large Rudraksha beads. And what the string contained was a large number of these, and each of them had been slit open, and on the inside was the text of the Gita Govinda, and then stamped back. So this necklace, the mala, was the entire text of the Gita Govinda.
Okay.
And somebody must have been wearing it around his neck, right? Carrying the Gita Govinda with him wherever he or she went, something like that. So this is the kind of level of surprises that you come upon when you really enter the field.
Thank you.